We must destroy the human race or Scorp.
We must destroy the world. Destroy the creatures, destroy the trees. Destroy the land and destroy the seas or Scorp. We must destroy the world.
Will it blend? That is the question.
The Doctor and Jamie just run out of the hospital ward and run back to the TARDIS. Once inside the TARDIS, the Doctor starts scanning the entire planet Earth for any faceless ones and chameleons activities anywhere else on the air. Doctor, what are you doing? Scanning for any chameleon presence anywhere else on the Earth. Want to know if the presence is just here or if it's worldwide. And I want to know if presence is emanated from here, emanated from somewhere else. The Doctor gets a fix on Oscorp in America. God. Facility called Oscorp. Appears to be a chameleon presence there as well. Haven't detected anything else in the world. Right, hold on tight, Jamie. We're going to materialise on the same planet in the same time period, so it may be a little bumpy. The Doctor and Jamie hold on tight to the console, and then the TARDIS dematerialises and then it rematerialises outside Oscorp. The Doctor and Jamie emerge and they see the evil doppelganger of George and the evil doppelgangers of the building then at work trying to build the zoo. They have now got all of the necessary things that they need from Wix and B&Q. Oh, what the hell's going on here, Jamie? I don't know what they're doing. Let's go and ask that chap over there. He points to George. The Doctor and Jamie walk over to George. Hello, sir. What are you doing here? Oh, we're building the zoo. The Doctor whispers something to Jamie. This is rather odd, Jamie, because why would they be building the zoo outside a facility like this? He points to Oscorp. It's obviously a chameleon. He points over his shoulder at the evil doppelganger of George. Derek has now gone back to his office, and the Doctor and Jamie walk into the Oscorp reception. Ah, good day, miss. Oh, good day. I'm here to speak to who's ever in charge here. Oh, that's Derek Brandon. He's on the top floor in his office at the moment. Do you have any authorization to see him? Because he doesn't just see anybody. It is a matter of great importance and urgency. It's an emergency. Yes, well, why don't you tell me first, because I decide what is important to Mr. Brandon and what's not. Surely Mr. Brandon can decide for himself, can't he?
Yes, well, don't tell him I said this, but he's
sometimes makes rash decisions that I don't agree with. Tell me what the emergency is, and I'll decide whether it's good enough an emergency to put Mr. Brandon himself. No, you don't understand. I can't tell you because you'll never believe me. Try me. There are aliens operating outside the Oscorp premises. They're building a zoo. You're serious, aren't you? Yes! How do you know about aliens? Well, it's hard, a little difficult to explain. I'm the doctor and this is Jamie. Doctor who? Exactly. Oh, I haven't got time for this. I'm getting pissed off. Misty presses a red button underneath her desk to bring the henchman and his security guards out. Oh, what's the matter, Misty? Get these people off of the premises now. Why, have they done something wrong? You never questioned me before, so why are you starting to question me now? Because you're not Mr. Banning. Derek's henchman just grabs Jamie and the doctor by the scruff of the neck and throws them off the premises. And don't come back. The henchman just turns and goes back inside the Oscorp premises. Oh, God. Should have given him a piece of my mind. He's worse than Packer, he is. Sorry, Jamie, calm down. I have to think of something. We have to get up to his office somehow. I'll just leave them to their own devices, Doctor. They obviously don't want our help. Yes, but they don't know that they need our help. Meanwhile, back in the Oscorp prison cells, Dad, how are we going to get out of here? How do you think, Harry? Norman uses a device on his wrist to bring the glider to the jail cells, and then the glider shoots all of the prisoners free from the jail cells. Now, time to take back my company. Derek may have founded it, but I was always really the boss deep down. Everybody knows it, really. All the prisoners make their way up to the reception area and just storm outside the Oscorp premises while an astonished Misty just sits behind the desk, open-mouthed, and she presses a red button underneath her desk to bring the henchman and his security guards out. Oh, what is it, Misty? You've got security reach. All of the prisoners are broken out of the prison cells. What? How did that happen? I don't know, but they just walked outside. They just ran outside the Oscorp premises. You have to go and get them immediately. Okay, will do. All right, you two, follow me. The henchman and his security guards just run out of the Oscorp premises, chasing after the escaped prisoners. The escaped prisoners manage to lose the henchman and the security guards. Then the henchman and the security guards just get back inside the Oscorp premises because they can't be bothered to look for them anymore. I'll just let them go. They're a bunch of annoying twats anyway, and we didn't even know what to do with them. Just don't tell Derek about this, boys. Norman and Harry accidentally separate from the rest of the group, and they come to a clearing of three red rucksacks and where the revival machine is. Even though the sheds blew up in the Nokia phone explosion, the revival machine still survives because it's not in the shed anymore, it's outside. Somebody has moved it there. And that somebody is Reggie Yates. And it is still intact because of the super heat-resistant and explosion-proof metals that it is made out of. Blade is alive because he's been revived by Reggie, because there has been a cover-up that Derek doesn't know about, and the Faceless Ones are in league with Reggie. Nurse Pinto is also alive because she's been revived by Reggie as well. Hello, I'm Reggie Yates, and welcome to Release the Hounds Extreme Hardcore Edition. What the hell is going on, Dad? Why is the revival machine being taken out of the shed? I don't know, Harry. I don't have all the answers. Don't even know who that guy is, either. Oh, I take it you two have never seen Release the Hounds, then? Oh, that's typical, because it's a UK show and we're in America now. What the hell is Release the Hounds, and why are you here, and what are you doing with the revival machine? I don't have to answer your questions. You just have to obey me. Now, inside these rucksacks is the Oscorp funding. What?! But that was stolen by Catwoman. Well, yes, it was, but I've managed to get it off of her. So, what happened to the other Catwoman? Because they were chasing each other. They had a bit of a fight, a bit of a scrap, and then in the chaos, I slipped in and just nicked the money from them and just put it in these three separate rucksacks. But what are you doing in this country in the first place? Well, we had to bring Release the Hounds over to America at some point, so may as well be now. Anyway, I brought this revival machine here because I'm going to revive Pascal Sauvage. Oh no, you're not. Got enough competition from Terry Brannan. Not having more competition from him. 2 days it happened. Reggie adjusts the settings on the revival machine and he revives Pascal Sauvage. Zoom, 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 zoom. What the hell? What's going on? I thought I was shot. What is going on? You've been revived. Ooh. That's lucky. Revived twice. I should have got those revival machines into mass production quicker. Took too much of a chance. Who's ruling over Oscorp now that they think I'm dead? Derek Brannan. Who the fuck is that? He's actually the founder of Oscorp. I'm not. Who is this prick? And why did he revive me? You're lucky I need you for this game show, Savage. Otherwise, I'll just shoot you again myself. What do you mean, again? You weren't the person who shot me the first time, were you? No. I was some prick called Malavi Quinn. How do you know that? Because he made it so friggin' obvious on Twitter. He called himself Unidentified Imperial Officer. I mean, who else could it be? It could be any Imperial Officer. Oh, whatever. I mean, he's the only one from the Sith Empire who's still alive. And I expect, all of the Galactic Empire ones are dead as well. How do you know about empires that are really far away in another galaxy? Because, I actually secretly have relatives in other galaxies. Yeah, I believe that. Not! Savage, that's so last decade. Well, not even last decade, last century. Anyway, I've already told Norman and Harry that Oscar Fountain is in these bags. What? But the Catwoman's nicked it. I've already explained to Norman and Harry. Well, you should have explained it after you revived him, shouldn't you, you prick? What's your tone, Osborne? I have to host the Top of the Pops Christmas special. I can't do it if I keep getting pissed off all of the time. And the New Year's Eve special as well. No, Savage, as I was saying, the Catwoman's, they were having a fight, and I secretly snuck in when they were having that fight and nicked the money from them. Now, you have to compete in Release the Hounds Extreme Hardcore Edition to have the Oscar funded for yourself.
Do I get all of it?
No, I'm afraid not. You split evenly between you. Well, I suppose it's better than nothing.
Fuck off, Norman. You want it all for yourself.
Oh, and you don't? It's interesting that Harry will get some. That depends if he manages to complete the dog run. Well, my son would have to inherit my company at some day, so may as well inherit some of the money as well. Right. It's £1 million between you. That is what is at stake here. And the reason it's extreme hard to release the hounds is because if you don't escape from the dogs by running away from them, then you will get eaten and killed by the dogs.
Seriously? I've been revived for sick entertainment like this?
Yeah, Savage.
Is this what happens in England? I know entertainment is sick in England, but I didn't think it was that sick. Oh wait, that whole thing when English got crowns, that was pretty sick. That was actually even sicker than this, actually.
Don't be so stupid, Savage.
Should the friggin' Archbishop of Canterbury's ass! Jesus is coming, look busy, my ass!
Savage, shut up and stop talking about old subjects. Right, I've had enough of this shit. Get the backpacks on and climb over that wall. And take these communicators as well so I can keep in contact with you. They do as Raji says. They take the communicators, climb over the wall with their rucksacks on, and then they participate in Release the Hounds Extreme Hardcore. All of the weird games that they have to play. Sort of similar as normal Release the Hounds. The only difference is with the dog run. At the beginning, obviously they have to duck under the fence and be wary of that dog that's tied up to the tree again, that barks at them really loudly. Meanwhile, the Doctor and Jamie are still outside Oscorp. Oh, it's no use, Jamie, we'll have to come back here later. The Doctor spots a newspaper in a bin. He goes over to the bin and takes the newspaper out of it. What's this? Oscorp in league with International Electromatics. Hey, Doctor, I thought they shut down when Vaughn and Packer died. Well, apparently, according to this, Jamie, Vaughn and Packer are still alive. No, that's a load of shit, Doctor. We saw them killed by the Cybermen with our own eyes. What are you talking about, Jamie? I saw Vaughn get killed, but I didn't see Packer get killed. And you didn't even see it, but either of them get killed. You just took my word for it. Oh, whatever, Doctor. Yes, I think we'll pay our Mr. Vaughn a visit. Why, Doctor? Some unfinished business with Mr. Vaughn. There's more to this than meets the eye, Jamie. This is bigger than you and me. Why are Vaughn and Packer still alive after being killed? Something must have brought them back to life. Something must have revived them. Perhaps they have some sort of machines, alien technology. Why is Vaughn getting involved with aliens again? Didn't he learn from last time? I thought he did. Obviously not. Perhaps he doesn't have a choice, Doctor. Maybe they're forcing him. And anyway, he has a sort of a debt to them if they have brought him back to life or revived him or whatever. Suppose you've got a point there, Jamie. I would be grateful as well if somebody brought me back to life. The Daughter and Jamie go back to the TARDIS and they just dematerialise and then they rematerialise outside the IE headquarters in London. And then they go into the International Electromatics reception where the stupid automated computer is. It has now been replaced. The Doctor and Jamie walk into the area where they got gassed last time and they get gassed again, knocked unconscious. And when they come to, they're in Vaughn's office. I must say, I'm surprised to see you two here again. And I'm surprised that you're even alive, Vaughn. Didn't you learn from last time what dealing with aliens causes to happen? What do you hope to accomplish by coming here, Delta? To persuade you not to deal with aliens again. You couldn't persuade me last time, you won't persuade me this time. I make my own decisions, Doctor. Well, I did persuade you in the end, kind of. Yes, well, we won't go into that, but forget that ever happened. That was my choice anyway. You had nothing to do with it. You just had a guilty conscience, Vaughn. Why did you go the same way again when you know that there was gas there? Because I couldn't think of a better way of getting directly to you. I mean, I'm sure there are other ways in, but I don't know where they are, and they probably don't lead to you or your office.
Are you in league with the Faceless Ones, the Chameleons, Vaughn? Just be honest. Doctor, when have I ever been honest with you? I just pretended to be honest. It's not in your nature to admit that, Vaughn. What can I say? I've changed with the times. Packer, bring our guests some refreshments, will you? Certainly, sir. Packer brings the Doctor and Jamie a cup of tea. Jamie whispers to the Doctor, "Let's pour this scalding hot tea all over him, Doctor, for what he did to us in the past." Jamie, shut up. Now, gentlemen, what else do you want to discuss? Just admit it, Vaughn. You're in league with whoever revived you, because you owe them a life debt. That was the case, but it was actually Pascal Savage's henchmen who revived me, and they revived Pascal Savage at the same time. But now, I'm not in league with that anymore. I am, as you say, in league with the Chameleons now. And why is that? Because I'm being forced to. Derek Brannan threatened my life. Then Captain Blade did as well. Captain Blade's still alive, but I thought he died. He's been revived as well. Oh, this just keeps getting better and better, Doctor. Quiet, Jamie. Where is Captain Blade now? I have no idea. Probably in that fucking space station of his. Oh, so you know how Chameleon Tours works, then? Yes, we had a visitor. His new right-hand man, Malachi Quinn. He explained it all to us. He gave us the message that Blade threatened mine and Packer's life, and Blade would only come to us in person if we refused to obey him, because then he would kill us. Oh, how very civilised of him. What do you mean, Doctor? I'm being sarcastic, Jamie. Keep up. Don't insult my intelligence, Doctor. Just fuck off, Jamie. Right, anyway. How am we going to go about this? You're not going to go about anything, Doctor, if I might say so. You've interfered for the last time. You can carry on drinking your refreshments, but you're being held in Professor Botkin's old lab at the moment. Packer, escort them there, please. Packer lifts the Doctor and Jamie up by the scruff of the neck and escorts them out of the office. Jamie and the Doctor are slurping their tea over the floor. Careful, man. Slopping my tea here. Mr. Vaughn said we could have the refreshments. Now we're only going to have part of them. Don't fucking care. Now move. Vaughn comes out of his office and comes into the corridor where Packer, the Doctor and Jamie are. For your information, Pascal Savage no longer poses a threat to me because he's dead. Yes, because that's right, he threatened my life as well. What? You never told me that, sir. I was being all civilised and nice to him. Well, he was being civilised and nice to me. I told you about the thing when he offered me a cup of tea. Doesn't matter now, Packer, he's dead. And his henchmen can't pose much of a threat. They can threaten our lives, but, I'm confident they're only making idle threats because they wouldn't be able to deal with you, Packer, even if it was three of them. Oh, thanks, sir. So you think Captain Blade poses more of a threat than Derek Brannan, are you? It's very wise, Vaughn. Yes, an alien threat does pose more of a threat than a human threat, I suppose. But then it depends whether that alien force is destructive or peaceful. In which case, Chameleons aren't really destructive as such, they just replace people.
Yes, by ruthless methods. Meanwhile, all of Wayne Enterprises' staff have been replaced by faceless ones. And Bruce doesn't even know about it. And neither does Alfred. And neither does Bullock and Gordon. that Bullock and Gordon have been tasked with investigating some odd transactions going on between Wayne Enterprises and Oscorp, including resources and finances, weapons and machinery, and technology.
Right, gonna have to take a bus up to New York City, Gordon. Are you ready for this? You even have to ask me that, Bullock. Hey, you're eager. I like it. How's Barbara these days? Don't talk about her. Sorry, I know when I've crossed the line. Well, you obviously don't, otherwise you wouldn't have said it in the first place. She left a note. What did the note say? None of your business, it's private. Well, you shouldn't have told me about the note in the first place, then. Oh, just shut up, Bullock. Bullock and Gordon take a bus to New York City, and then they take a taxi to the Oscorp premises. They enter the reception area, misty as that. Oh, hello, gentlemen. What do you want? We're from the Gotham City Police Department, and we're here to investigate some odd transactions going on between Wayne Enterprises and Oscorp. I don't know much about that, I'm afraid. You have to consult Derek Bannon, our manager and founder. He's on the top floor. But do you have clearance to see him or authorization to see him?
We don't need it. We're the frickin' police, love.
Oh, yes, of course. All right. Misty presses a button to bring the lift down, and Bullock and Gordon enter it. Then she presses another button to take the lift up. When the lift reaches the top floor, Gordon and Bullock emerge from it, and they make their way to Derek's office. Bullock knocks on the door. Mr. Brannan, Scotland City, please open up, please. Brannan?
Bullock knocks the door down because he doesn't get any response from Derek, and that is because Derek isn't in there. Gordon and Bullock end up taking all of the books off of the bookcase until the bookcase slides open and the secret room is revealed. Gordon and Bullock enter the secret room and they start rummaging through the files within. Bullock is just about to read a file when Derek bursts in. What the fuck are you doing in there? Don't you read that file? Derek just snatches the file from Bullock. I suggest you leave at once. Bullock goes up to Derek and looks him right in the eyes. Why? What are you going to do about it? If we stay, we're the police, mate. You don't have a warrant. If you don't leave, then I'll phone New York police on you, and you can explain to them why you were intimidating me. Now you better leave before security arrive. I've already pressed the button underneath my desk. How do we know that? You could just be lying. But do you really want to take that chance? Gordon and Bullock leave the secret room, and they leave the office, and they make their way back to the lift.
Meanwhile, the Wayne Enterprises employees, who are actually faceless ones, have gone to the Oscorp premises to tell the evil doppelganger of George and the building man that they will be helping in terms of financing the zoo being made and in terms of getting animals imported to be put in the zoo and the building of it.
Gordon and Bullock just go down to the reception area, and then they go outside the Oscorp premises and they see who they believe to be Wayne Enterprises employees when they're actually chameleons. What do we do, Bullock? Just for once, Gordon. Just leave it. Please. This is over our heads. We can't do anything about it. If we try, we'll end up dead, trust me. Just this once. I've trusted you many times in the past. Now it's time for you to trust me. Alright, just this once. And only because this is outside of Gotham. We need to concentrate our efforts on Gotham. Otherwise, things will get even more out of hand in that city than they already have, if that's even possible. Oh, believe me, it's possible. Things were much worse before you came along. Oh, so you were just sat on your fast doing nothing before I came along then? Something like that. I liked eating donuts more back then. Well, I still like eating donuts now, but I used to eat more back then. What can I say? I was bored as shit. You just made my life exciting, Gordon. Well, I get a lot of excitement out of Barbara, but that's why I miss her so much. Oh, stop being so sappy. Get a grip. Do you even have a girlfriend, Bullock? I've had many girlfriends. Never had a permanent one like you. Gordon and Bullock just go back to Gotham.
The evil doppelganger of George has bought a camel outside the Oscorp premises, ready to be put in the zoo. Derek is appalled when he sees this. Fucking camel? What next? A freaking giraffe? Vaughn goes back to his office and Packer takes the Doctor and Jamie into Watkins' old lab and locks the door behind them. Then he goes back to Mr. Vaughn's office. Meanwhile, the Release the Hounds episode is nearing its climax.
So far, Norman and Harry have made their way out with their £1 million. Now it's only Savage left to try and make his way out. Savage, are you ready for the dog run?
Yes, as ready as I'll ever be.
Savage attempts the dog run, but he only gets halfway, and he gets eaten and killed by the pack of dogs.
They turned out my insides!
Quite entertaining to watch, actually. Reggie is just staring at Savage getting eaten alive, and he's smiling. Well, congratulations, Harry and Norman. You've got your £1 million, so they also got funded. Too bad Savage didn't get his. So we've just lost £1 million of the Oscar funding because Savage has just been a dick and only got half back. Pretty much, yeah. I mean, it doesn't really matter because you wouldn't have had it either way. Either Savage would have had it, or you wouldn't have had it at all, which is what has happened. And let's face it, we know Savage wouldn't have given you a penny. He would have just spent it on what he wanted. But it's pointless spending this money on Oscorp stuff now because Derek's the boss of Oscorp. Nothing gets in and out of his facility but without his say-so. Well, I suppose you could set up like a secret area underneath it. Derek doesn't know about. Yeah, that would be very hard to keep a secret, though. Oh, how do you know that there's secret areas underneath Oscorp? Reggie just runs off. Oi, come back here, you little prick. Set my glider on you. I never thought I'd say this, but poor Savage. Poor French prick. Norman uses the device on his wrist to bring the glider to their location, and he uses the glider to pick Reggie up by the scruff of the neck. You think you're getting away with doing that? Put me down, please! I didn't sign up for this! But you signed up to see people getting eaten alive, did you? Surely you found it as entertaining as I did to see that Frenchy meat maker. Wasn't him getting shot enough for you? Obviously not. Let's see how you like paying yourself.
No, please don't!
Norman uses the blades on the glider to stab Reggie right through the heart, and Reggie dies.
Oh, fuck! No more Top of the Pops Christmas or New Year's Eve specials. Fern can't do it on her own.
Reggie's corpse just falls to the ground. The dogs start eating that. Dad, wasn't that a bit? He deserved it, son. You said it yourself, poor Savage. Reggie's a sick bastard. Well, he was a sick bastard.
Norman and Harry make their way back to the Oscorp premises, and they go in the basement, and they find the Emperor there.
Meanwhile, the evil doppelganger of George, the faceless ones who replaced the Wayne Enterprises employees, and the faceless ones who replaced the building man, all go over to Africa to Leopard's Den. The monkey that was on George's shoulder went with the evil doppelganger of George, thinking that it was actually George, because she trusts that face. Anyway, they all start nicking the animals from Leopard's Den and packing them into storage crates and loading them onto the backs of vans and lorries. Everybody is out apart from Jupiter C, and he tries and stops them with his sniper rifle, but he misses every time. And the evil doppelganger of George sets his monkey on Jupe, and it starts attacking Jupe's face and scratching it until it's bloody.
Oh, bloody hell, I wish Trevanion was there to sort this shit out. Oh!
Among the animals that they nick include a lion, an elephant, and a giraffe. Then they all go back to Oscorp and put the animals in specially designated pens that they have built. They use the chameleon tourist plane to get from the USA to Africa, and to get from Africa to the USA.
Joyce has been turned into a faceless one, and the original version of Joyce has been taken up to the space station and turned into a hypnotic state. And she has been shrinked down to a model size. And the evil doppelgangers of Matteo, Les, Liam and Kenneth have gone over to America to assist the evil doppelganger of George and the building man with building the zoo.
Vaughn, it's me. Yes, what do you want, Mr. Branning? I don't like your tone, Vaughn. I'm sorry, what do you want, Mr. Branning? Well, basically, I hate to break this news to you, but we're going to have to cancel the IE and Oscorp conference. Why is that? Because us being open and public has brought about lots of disasters and chaos. I'm sure you're aware of that by what you've been reading in the newspapers and seeing on the news. Yes, I am, sir. The last thing we want is to be more open and public at this time, as it would be very disagreeable in the long run, because it would just make things even more disastrous and chaotic. So you've reconsidered, sir. I understand completely. It's a pity, though, because it was the first one. Well, it was going to be the first one. Yes, I know. I'm not saying it's cancelled for good. I'm just saying for the time being, Derek hangs up.
In Derek's office, he gets a phone call from Tom Dixon from Blendsec. Hello, it's Tom Dixon here.
Will it blend? That is the question.
Oh, just piss off.
I think I'll press the neodymium button.
Why was I be interested in blenders? Because I was wondering if Oscorp wanted to go into partnership with Blendsec, because I heard your chef Ainsley was in need of a new blender, because the ones that the previous owner, Pascal Sauvage, gave him were kind of shit, weren't they? How do you know about that? Have you got Blendsec agents inside Oscorp? Ah, that would be telling, wouldn't it, mate? Look, I'm not your mate, now just piss off. I've told you once already. Derek just hangs up. But Tom comes along to Oscorp a few hours later anyway, and he goes up to the receptionist's desk. Hello, I'm Tom Dixon. I'm here to speak to Mr. Brannan. Well, he's rather busy at the moment, so I'm afraid you can't see him unless you've got an appointment. Oh, I see. Could I just take this blender to the kitchen section to show Ainsley? Tom is holding the Blendsec blender. Oh, right, I'll be lenient this time. The receptionist gives him an Oscorp visitor's badge, and Tom goes along to Ainsley's kitchen. Ah, Mr. Harriet, I've got a Blendsec blender here for you because I heard you were in need of one. Oh, yes, that'll be brilliant, mate, thanks. Ainsley just takes the blender off of Tom's hands, and he just puts it next to his frying pans and his saucepans. Right, aren't you going to pay me for it then, mate? You're not having it for free. Well, how much is it? £100? Because these are the most powerful blenders in the world, you know. I know, mate, I have watched the YouTube series. Well, yeah, because I'm a celebrity, I can afford that easily, so here you go. Ainsley takes two £50 notes out of his wallet and just hands them to Tom. Tom then leaves Oscorp. Oh, this would be brilliant to blend all my drugs up in. Derek buys an Xbox, and Ainsley also buys an Xbox. They are Xbox 360s. They both go on an online match of Modern Warfare 2 with each other after they have added each other as friends. Ainsley's player name is The World's Finest Chef, and Derek's player name is East End's Finest. But then Ainsley manages to get all of the kills without dying, and Derek just gets killed every time, and he doesn't even get a single kill. Ha! Call of Duty Black Peppers, bitch! Ainsley says this over the headset. Ugh. This isn't friggin' Black Peppers. This isn't even Black Ops. This is Modern Warfare 2. Derek gets a phone call from Anne Summers. Hello. I want to know whether or not your company would consider going into partnership with Anne Summers. Why the hell was I going to do that? This is a freaking factory complex that specialises in chemicals and robotics and technology. Why would we be interested in some retail outlet shop that sells bondage stuff and sex toys? Well, we know that you're open-minded, Derek, and we thought, don't call me Derek, when was this ever a first name basis? Call me Mr. Brannan. Sorry, Mr. Brannan. We heard that you're open-minded, so we thought your customers and your employees would be open-minded as well. So I just thought, since you're having a zoo built outside, that you would be up for something like this. Number one, a zoo is a totally different thing. And number two, I didn't want the zoo to be built outside, They just forced me into that.
Well, we were thinking of going into partnership with Grey Enterprises as well.
Well, why don't you just go into partnership with them and not Oscorp, lad?
Because we feel it would be mutually beneficial between our three companies to create some sort of merger that would enable us to make the most profit possible and generate the highest possible income.
Well, this is just bullshit, I'm sorry. You're trying to con me, aren't you? I'm not gullible, love.
I see, Mr. Brannan. See where this is going.
Do you? Well, I think you're lying. What's Grey Enterprises got to do with this, anyway?
We have Alzheimer's spies inside their office block, and our spies report that they have seen Christian Grey participating in sexual acts. So our spies have come to the assumption that he's into that sort of thing.
Well, it's not really an assumption. They have proof because they saw it with their own eyes.
Right, we're not having a merger, right? Because that would make me have to change the company name. And it would make me lose money because I would have to share the profits with you rather than having them all for myself.
Well, that's just selfish, Mr. Brannan.
No, it's a serious decision you're asking me to make here, a high executive decision.
What, are you not capable of doing that, Mr. Brannan?
Maybe it was only Savage and Norman who had guts then.
Oh, shut up, bitch. I have more guts than both of them put together. I'm in, but not the merger part, just the three-way partnership.
Oh, you like three-ways, do you, Mr. Brannan?
Oh, just shut up, love. Otherwise, I'll go back on my word.
We have to know if you're going to be a trusted client.
Yeah, so I can be trusted.
Your tone doesn't inspire much confidence.
Look, love, I have the high ground here. Now, you better accept my decision before I change my mind.
Very good, sir. I'll let Mr. Grey know at once.
And tell him to phone me when you've told him.
Very good, sir. Derek hangs up.
About 5 minutes later, he gets a call from Christian Grey.
Ah, hello. I heard you want to go into business with me, do you?
Yes, that's correct.
What about it?
Well, that Anne Summers woman said that you wanted to speak to me over the phone.
Yes, I wanted to confirm with you if this three-way partnership between Oscorp Grey Enterprises and Anne Summers was okay with you. I wanted to confirm it, so the words definitely come from your mouth.
Yes, I'm happy with it. I'll ship you some of my bondage stuff, like my blindfolds and my whips, and I'll throw in some sex toys as well. Also, hot candle wax as well. I'll tell like the Anne Summers woman to ship some of their stuff to you as well.
Okay, very good.
Bye. Derek hangs up. The next day, a lorry from Grey Enterprises comes outside the Oscorp premises carrying sex toys and bondage and stuff. And another lorry, which is an Anne Summers lorry, also comes outside the Oscorp premises that also has bondage stuff and sex toys in. But they can't get free because the evil doppelganger of George and the building men are still building the zoo. Derek comes outside of the Oscorp premises.
What the fuck is going on? I knew something like this would happen.
Oh, here he is, the deckhead himself.
Oh, just laugh it up, George. Go on.
But I'm not George, remember?
Just say that more loudly so more people can hear.
No, because that would be stupid, wouldn't it, Derek? Don't insult my intelligence. It was a joke. Lighten up. You chameleons have no sense of humour. You're too serious.
If we had too much of a sense of humour, then we wouldn't be able to take over the world, would we?
Not necessarily. Derek gets his Oscorp employees to put up a partition between the zoo building and the lorries so that the lorries can get through. And then Derek's henchman and the security guards start unloading the stuff from the lorries.
Boss, what the fuck is all this? What have you got us into now?
Don't question, man. Just obey. A very good sir.
And Summers fans have to go on the same side of the partition that the lorries went on to get inside the Oscorp premises.
Dr. Connors enters the lab and Gwen is just lied down on one of the lab's desks with some sort of black suit on and a whip.
Gwen, what the fuck are you doing?
Oh, firstly, Dr. Connors, you like it, don't you?
Get down from there!
Gwen just doesn't move. Meanwhile, Derek makes his way back up to his office and he bursts in to find Christian Grey there with Anastasia still.
What the fuck are you doing in my office?
He has her tied up
and bound in a bondage style with a blindfold on, and he is whipping her. He even has some hot wax that he is pouring on her. Not only are you in my office, but you're also performing sexual acts in my office. This does not look good for my reputation at all. I haven't signed any contracts yet. This doesn't look very professional. Well, it looks professional if you're a company that specialises in sex toys. And Summers and your company does, but mine doesn't. Well, no, my company doesn't. It only just got into that recently. I thought since our companies have a partnership now, I can make myself at home. No, because even if we did have a merger, you still wouldn't have authorization to even enter my office, let alone perform sexual acts in it. Now get out! Anastasia is barefoot and she's got her ankles tied and her hands tied. Christian has to untie the velvet material from her ankles and from her wrists. And they both get their clothes back on because Christian had his shirt off. And then they leave Derek's office. They are approaching the lift when they turn back to Derek. Christian just has an annoyed look on his face. Anastasia goes up to Derek. You sure I can't tempt you with something? Just piss off, both of you. Anastasia bites the end of a Grey Enterprise's pencil and walks past Derek in an alluring and sexy fashion. And then she walks back into Derek's office and slots the pencil neatly in Derek's pencil case. Then she walks back out to where Christian and Derek are stood. Just a goodbye gift. But it's also a hello gift as well. Because me and Christian are married, you see. So if you're working with him, then you're working with me.
Well, it's more like a long-distance partnership it was going to be.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that. I wanted to get closer to you, to get to know you a little better.
That's enough, Anastasia.
Oh, are you getting jealous, Christian?
They walk over to the lift and they get in it and go down to the ground floor.
Then they walk through the reception and outside.
They both leave Oscorp. It turns out that the Grey Enterprises and Summers actually released the sex gas from Torchwood, and that's how it affected the chameleons. But it turns out that only some of the chameleons was infected by sex gas, not all of them. Nurse Pinto and Blade were not affected by the sex gas, and neither was the new nurse that he has up on the space station.
Suddenly, the Justice League's watchtower locks on to the Chameleon Tour space station, and Martian Manhunter is on the computer in there. Security alert! Security alert!
What on earth? Something's invaded our airspace.
Better let the Justice League know about this.
Martian Manhunter presses a button on his computer to relay a message to all members of the Justice League down on the Earth. Justice League, this is Martian Manhunter. You need to come to the watchtower immediately. An unidentified space station has invaded our airspace. All the Justice League and Zatanna go to the watchtower. The evil doppelganger of George and the building men are getting the rest of the resources and the building materials to build the zoo from the Chameleon Tour space station. They're getting it pulled down in planes. Blade goes down to the Earth to check out how George and the building men are getting on with regards to building the zoo. And he spots Lord Sugar just emerging from the forest. His clothes torn, his body and face dirty. Blade goes over to Sugar.
Sir, what's the matter? What's happened to you?
I've been out here for days. It's a freaking long story. But basically, I used to own that company you see before you.
What, was Oscorp?
Yes. But the actual founder of it, Derek Rannan, who I didn't even know about until a few days ago, he's taken it from me. And he's thrown me out of the facility.
Basically, I was tied to a chair and gagged. And I managed to find a rock to cut myself free. And I've just been surviving on rainwater all of this time.
Right, sure, come in with me. I'll sort you out. And I'll get your facility back in your hands.
You promise?
Yes, for my name isn't Captain Blade.
Captain Blade? Are you the captain of some sort of plane?
I'm the captain of Chameleon Tours. It's a travel company. What destinations do you go to? That's confidential information, I'm afraid. And if I reveal that to you, then I couldn't help you, I'm afraid. Why should I trust you? Because you don't have a choice. Blades takes a gas canister out of his pocket and squirts it in Lord Sugar's face, which makes Lord Sugar go unconscious. Then Blades takes a convenient horse flight back up to the space station. And then he puts Lord Sugar in a hypnotic trance. And he goes down to the size of a model. And then an evil doppelganger of Lord Sugar is made. Blades puts the evil doppelganger of Lord Sugar onto a Chameleon Tours flight that goes down to the Earth. It goes down to London. And it takes Lord Sugar's place in his building where he does The Apprentice. Derek goes outside and sees them taking the building materials and resources off of the planes. Derek walks over to the evil doppelganger of George. Where have those planes been to get those building materials and those resources? None of your business. Oh, fuck off, mate. Gaius suddenly comes out and sees Derek. Gaius, just in time.
You can use your magic to get rid of these twats. As you wish, sire. All of them you want got rid of?
Yes, please.
Oh, don't be absurd, you can't have magic. Magic is just made up. Only science is real.
Gaius just uses his magic on the evil doppelganger of George and all of the building men, and they just run away like cowardly people.
The evil doppelgangers of Kenneth, Liam, Les and Matteo are also scared by Gaius' magic, and they also run like cowards. And they board a Chameleon Tours flight back to Venator, and then they carry on assisting the evil doppelganger of Joyce with the running of the Solana. The Wayne Enterprises employees also get scared by Gaius' magic, and they board a Chameleon Tours flight back to Gotham so that they can carry on running Wayne Enterprises, and so that they can have a board meeting.
Excellent, Gaius. I only wish you were here sooner. Where have you been all this time? I was trying to find you, Zaya. I've been in the kitchens with Ainsley. And how's he getting on with tonight's grub? If it's not almost ready, then I have cause for concern. You should have more faith in him, Zaya. He's doing an exceptional job. You're overworking him.
Oh, yes, maybe you're right.
Should be a bit more lenient to people who are the most loyal to me.
But, that doesn't mean that I'm soft-minded. Follow me, Gaius.
Gaius follows Derek onto one of the Chameleon Tours planes. And because all of the stuff has been unloaded from it, the plane takes off. Gaius and Derek hide between the seats. And then the plane makes its way up to the Chameleon Tours space station. And once the people who are flying the plane get off of it, Derek and Gaius disembark. And they sneak quietly and stealth-like into the area where Blade is. What the fuck are you doing here? Get them out of here!
Some faceless ones rush towards Derek and Gaius, but Gaius knocks them to the floor with his magic. Then the Justice League suddenly burst into the space station in the area where Blade is, and Zatanna and Gaius are side by side using their magic to fend off the faceless ones.
Oh, this is quite exhilarating, isn't it, my girl? Whoever you are.
Oh, yes, it is.
Superman is using his freeze breath and lasers to stop some of the faceless ones in their tracks. And Hawkman is using his club to beat some of their heads. Wonder Woman is using her lasso to tie some of the faceless ones up. And the Flash is knocking loads of faceless ones unconscious with his superior speed because he knocks the faceless ones off of their feet. Everything is in chaos and disarray. Blade presses some buttons on the console. The space station activates its self-defense system. And some laser turrets start firing at the Justice League, Gaius and Derek. But Gaius protects Derek. Derek punches one of the faceless ones in the face. And he grabs one of them by the neck and pushes him up against the wall. The faceless ones have blasters on their new space station. And Quinn picks one up. Quinn suddenly starts shooting at Zatanna, but Zatanna pushes Quinn to the floor with her magic. But then Quinn gets up, and Blade and Quinn make a break for an escape pod, and the escape pod jettisons into outer space. Quinn and Blade have escaped.
chaos up in space as the Justice League Watchtower has identified an unidentified space station invading its airspace. The Justice League are in the process of trying to remove what appears to be a threat. We are getting reports that there is severe damage done to the hull of this new unidentified space station. There are holes in it and smoke coming out of those holes. We think that some of this may have been caused by Superman's lasers. Vaughn is in his office and he's watching the news.
Oh, wonderful, Packer. This is just what I wanted. Now those faceless ones can't order me about or threaten my life.
And they can't push you about or threaten your life either, Packer. You must be as relieved as I am. Yes, of course, Mr. Vaughn, I am. Obviously. Don't say obviously, because you sound like Quinn there. Oh, don't compare me with that swat. I only let him get away with that stuff because you told me to. What, would you rather have risked being killed? I suppose you've got a point there, sir. Exactly, Packer. I think ahead, you don't. That's the difference between me and you. And that's why I was the leader of this company in the first place, and you weren't. You were just a simple henchman. And you still are. Finn is in the UK watching the news. Oh, this destruction is pathetic. This destruction is worse than one of Liz's schemes. Liz enters the room that Finn is in and she has just overheard what he said. What are you saying about my schemes, Finn? Ah, oh, don't worry about that now, Liz. What's going on anyway? Liz gestures to the tally. Justice League just identified some sort of unidentified space station in their vicinity and they're attacking it. They think it may be a threat. Well, that doesn't sound good. But then, nothing is usually good when the Justice League have to get involved. Too bad your friend the Commissioner isn't still alive. Maybe he could have maintained order in this situation. Your sarcasm is as weak as ever, Finn. One day, it'll get so weak that it'll explode just like the Death Star. What, you mean a thing that is inevitably going to get destroyed? Yes, you'll inevitably get destroyed.
I'm sorry.
I'm fucking with you, Finn.
Sometimes it's just nothing to say. I just have to think of something random. Or you could just stay quiet. If I stayed quiet all my life, Liz, I wouldn't be in this job now. And if you stayed quiet all of your life, you wouldn't be in this job now. You wouldn't have even got as far as working at Instagram, let alone being the head of communications for this police force. But we're not in the business of stating the obvious. So why have we suddenly started doing it now? You started doing it. No, you did. Oh, we're resorting to being childish now, are we? Oh, just shut up and give me your heel.
I'll give you my heel, all right, Finn. Liz takes her heel off and throws it at Finn's face and it hits him right on the nose and his nose starts bleeding. Oh, fuck you, bitch!
I haven't killed anyone yet. I am tired of being the angel on your shoulder every time the shit starts to fly.
You'll get worse next time, Finn. Liz collects her heel and puts it back on her foot and then walks out of the room. I'll get her back. Somehow.
I gave her 6 months and she's scrambled eggs.
Communication is no longer a one-way street. A 24/7 world requires 360 degrees of communication.
It's honest. It's transparent. It's good PR.
Finn is desperate, so he manages to spy on Liz with a pair of binoculars from a vantage point on top of a building. He is spying on her while she's at home. He sees that somebody is slipping drugs into her shoes.
I'm so not okay with that.
This is why you have no friends.
So he takes this as an advantage to degrade her good name. And he's going to tell the press about it in an attempt to get her fired and possibly sent to prison. Finn's pupils enlarge when he sees Liz having sex with the same person who slips drugs into her shoes. And he carries on looking through the binoculars. He is going to tell the press about this as well in another attempt to degrade her good name. He thinks of a damaging headline in his head. Something like, druggy PR woman in sexy romp with her dealer.
This is so far off the record, even I don't know I'm seeing.
Because the Emperor has been tracking the ship that Quinn and the Sith Lords arrived in, he goes out into the forest and finds it, and then he gets his Imperial troops to detach one of the revival machines from the ship and take it into the Oscorp basement, where he makes modifications to it. He adds in a speech recognition system and a teleporter that teleports people from not just other times, but other dimensions as well.
We must destroy the human race, Oscorp. We must destroy the world. Destroy the creatures, destroy the trees. Destroy the land and destroy the seas, Oscorp. We must destroy the world.